So today in numerical methods, I like to take a small excursion and talk a little bit about implementation design. Yeah? So we did some programming code sessions, some live coding, just to illustrate numerical methods. Yeah, maybe you remember with the low discrepancy sequences, etc. We did some experiments, but I never invested a lot of time in providing a very good object-oriented design, because the code was often just to illustrate a small aspect of a numerical method. And now we have multiple numerical methods for our maybe application here, mathematical finance. And it's maybe good to think a little bit, what are the objects or classes that we should create that can be reused later? So among the stuff that we looked at was in our very first session, the computer arithmetic. So we looked at floating point arithmetic, and there we had a look, for example, at Kahan summation. So there was an algorithm that allows us to calculate a sum, or for the Monte Carlo method, then later the expectation of a sample vector with a small rounding error. So this algorithm. I do not want to write this algorithm again and again. And then we had the Monte Carlo method as a numerical method. So we learned how to approximate the expectation. So we can approximate the expectation by a finite sample vector, taking the average over this sample vector, so a clear application of this Kahan summation. Then to generate such sample vectors, we needed random number generation. So there was random number generation. And if we want to generate other distributions, like a normal distributions, there is the inversion of the distribution function. Then we moved on. Yeah? So now we know how to sample a random variable, and we know how to calculate the expectation or approximate the expectation. Then we moved on to stochastic processes and had the time discretization of the stochastic process. So there was the Euler scheme, so given here, which allows us to generate a family of random variables from the specification of the E2 process. And there was also a special case for this E2 process. We looked at the special case of a log normal process. So the log normal process had here a special coefficient in front of the diffusion part. And then we observed if we move to the log coordinate, then there are different ways of discretizing this, and discretizing the log of the process had a much smaller discretization error. And in the end, we could also say that there is something like an exact discretization, or it's actually the exact solution, if the coefficients are piecewise constant, or if we know the integrals of these coefficients. So now I like to plug everything together and talk a little bit about how we should implement these numerical methods such that I can reuse the method in many different applications. For example, I do not want to implement a Kahan summation again and again. So there should be one part of my program that takes care about calculating the expectation. So a few remarks on design, object-oriented design or software design. So the first step is that we need to perform some abstraction of our mathematical concepts. So I will create classes and interfaces for different mathematical concepts. And the question is now, what are the right boundaries where we should cut our program in two different parts? Yeah. So is it a good idea to have a separate part that creates random numbers? And how can I abstract this from the remaining part of my problem. So the means to perform abstraction is the interface. So we will define interfaces. So interfaces is just a description of methods that can be performed on an object. And the interfaces will provide the abstraction. Okay, this is what can be done. And then implementing the interfaces, we have different options. So implementing the interfaces, we have different options of how it can be done. So then it may be that we like to combine several parts and create a composition. Yeah. So this is also where you have to understand the mathematical concepts and ask yourself what belongs together. So one part is you should cut at the right boundaries. The other part is, so what are the things that belong together? A very nice example for the things that belong together comes from a mathematical finance theorem. Yeah? So you know Gersanov's theorem. If you change to a different probability measure, it is equivalent to the change of the drift. And then there is the universal pricing theorem that tells you, okay, that you should move, or that it's quite nice to move to an equivalent martingale measure associated with a certain numerator. So a certain numerator is associated with a certain measure. Moving to a certain measure is associated with a certain drift. So of course, from a mathematical point, the numerator and the drift are connected. So you could then think of that drift and numerator belong together and they form some union. Yeah? So you should combine the two in a composition. The next part is if I start implementing now, say, a solution for some problem, I can immediately think about future extensions. So you should design your program for extension. So for example, you know, if you have a Black-Scholes model and you move to the log coordinate, then you have a stochastic process, an E2 process with constant coefficients. Yeah? So log S is R minus 1/2 sigma squared dt. R minus 1/2 sigma squared is a constant, plus sigma dw. Sigma is a constant. So in the log coordinate, you have an SDE with constant coefficient. But there are many mathematical models that have coefficients that are far more complicated. You can have stochastic volatility as an example. So not only can sigma be a function of time, sigma can also be a random variable. So you should consider future extensions from the beginning. So if I, an example for this now, if I write down an Euler scheme, I will not just write down an Euler scheme for an SDE that has constant coefficients. I will just write down the general case, and then Black-Scholes moving to log coordinates is just a special case of this formulation. And then the last remark I like to make on this slide is that I prefer that the code is readable and concise. So I like to write code that somehow documents itself by just reflecting the mathematical ideas. And I will not so much care about performance from the beginning. So my first intention is to make the code readable and concise, so short code. And then later I can still consider, okay, how I can make it fast. Yeah? So first make it work, then make it fast. Yeah? But my priority is also make it nice. So the code should be readable. Maybe a last remark for this: code should be readable. The virtual machine, for example, the Java virtual machine takes care of a lot of things. Yeah. So for example, if you allocate memory, he will use a memory pool, yeah, or he will optimize your code on the fly. Yeah, so so sometimes you can write code that looks a little bit inefficient, and actually you do not spot a difference in the performance. So I like to follow a little bit these rules, and now look at an application. I will illustrate these aspects now in two applications. The first one is the evaluation of a European option under the Black-Scholes model. And the second one is then the simulation of an Euler scheme, and maybe we can use that to value a more complicated financial product, for example, an Asian option. Yeah, for an Asian option, you need multiple time steps. So I have now two applications. I like to use all the numerical methods we have discussed so far, and I would like to make a design that is designed for extensions and allows me to reuse the components. So to reuse my numerical methods in future problems. Okay, so let's shortly review the application, evaluation of a call option under the Black-Scholes model, and then have a code session where I solve this, say, once, twice, a third time, yeah, in different ways. Yeah, and I hope that you will see that we will slowly move to a more advanced design. So from the universal pricing theorem, so this is the thing that if I choose a numerator and I move to the equivalent martingale measure, so the measure under which all traded products divided by the numerator are martingales, yeah, so the processes of the relative values are martingales, then I have the theorem that I can use this property also for the value of a financial derivative. So the financial derivative divided by the numerator is a martingale, the financial derivative value. So V divided by N is a martingale. So that means if I would like to calculate or evaluate V at little t, I take the expectation of V of capital T divided by N of capital T. So that guy here. Okay, because that's the martingale. And then I just multiply with N of little t. Now, because the expectation of this part here, conditional time little t, is just V of little t divided by N of little t. So I can reformulate this as this nice little valuation formula. So if you know the value at a future point in time, capital T, then you can calculate the corresponding value at an earlier time, little t. So here I just consider a single mature T, yeah, or payment date. So I assume that my financial derivative pays the amount V of capital T in capital T. Then if I'm in this situation, I know the payment, for example, as a function of other stochastic quantities. An example is the call option on the underlying S. So with maturity capital T and strike K. So this option pays here V of capital T. So pays the amount maximum of S of T minus K and zero in capital T. So this financial product pays me S of T, the value of the stock in time capital T minus K. If S of T minus K is positive, and this amount is paid in capital T. So this here is V of T paid in capital T. So it's paid in capital T, and since it's paid in capital T, I know the value in capital T, and that means I have to divide here by the numerator seen in capital T. So this means if I know the quantity S of capital T, and if I know the numerator or the ratio of the numerator, n of capital T and n of little t, then I can calculate the value of this financial product. So the financial product is given by here a function, the payoff function, maximum of u minus k and zero divided by v, where u and v are the two quantities which come from my market, the value of the stock and the value of the numerator. Actually, the value of the numerator divided by n of little t, so the performance of the numerator. So these are the quantities that are provided by the model. And these are the quantities that describe the financial product. The maturity, the strike, the payoff function describe the financial product. Okay, so the question is, what is S of T and what is N of T? So this is now given by my model. So the model is something separate. Yeah? The model is now modeling the behavior of my market. So we consider here the Black-Scholes model. So under the Black-Scholes model, I consider the numerator e to the rt, yeah, a bank account with a continuous accrual, yeah, with accrual rate r. And my asset S is assumed to follow a log normal process. So the one that we had in the example for the Euler scheme. So under my equivalent martingale measure, this process looks like this. Okay, so the equivalent martingale measure, so under the measure Qn, this means that the Brownian motion is here a Brownian motion under Qn, and my drift is here R. Yeah? So this will lead to the fact that S divided by N will then be a martingale. Okay, so you see, you can express S of capital T now as a function of parameters, namely the model parameters, initial value of the stock, interest rate, volatility. So these are the model parameters. Given a random variable that represents the Brownian motion. Yeah? So W is here the Brownian motion. So W of T is normal distributed random variable with mean zero and standard deviation square root of T. So that guy is the Brownian motion. So this will give me here a dependency on a random variable X. So actually I can write S of capital T, so under this model, the value of the stock at a future point in time, capital T, as a function here of this normal distributed random variable X. And if you look, it's mean zero standard deviation square root of T. If you write X as square root of T times Z, then Z is a standard normal. So you can write everything as a function of a standard normal. So this standard normal, Z or X, is the only thing that introduces the randomness. Yeah. So it's the generator of the risk. Yeah. So it's the stochastic driver. So maybe later we should have some interface and then some class implementing this interface, providing the Brownian motion, because at this place we need to consider how do we generate random numbers, how do we generate a normal distribution, and so on. All the other things are just functional transformation of random variables. So you see, the next concept is maybe how do we do transformation of random variables. All the operations here, the plus, the minus, the logarithm, they all act on random variables. So maybe add this here as a remark. So here the arithmetic operators act on random variables. So I have this function h1 of x. So I call this function that gives me s of t as a function of my normal distributed random variable h1 of x. If you go back here, you see that my payoff function, so the function g that appears here in this expectation, is a function of two random variables, s of capital T and n of capital T divided by n of little t. So I also need to generate the n. So I can consider this here as a function h that generates the vector that is needed in the calculation of the financial product. So the vector that I need in this European option example is just these quantities at a single time at capital T. I need here the vector h of x, which is s of t in the first component and n of capital T divided by n of little t in the second component. So I have here these two guys. So if I know the model parameters, so my model parameters are here the guys R, sigma, okay, R again here, and the initial value. If I know my model parameters, and if I know the parameters of the financial product, so the financial product parameters are this time here, then I can create this vector and I can plug this vector in the valuation formula. Okay, so second step is create the model quantities that we need to perform the valuation. So I can combine the two steps. So now I have h of x, which is the model generating the value of the stock and the value of the numerator at maturity. Then I have g applied to these two quantities, which is the financial product. Okay, g of h of x is then the discounted payoff of which I would like to calculate the expectation. So if I use Monte Carlo with Kahan summation, then I know how to calculate now the expectation out of this sample vector. So finally, we may approximate the expectation here with a Monte Carlo method. So you see that here I have a conditional expectation. So that was because I was just generalizing this. So I was considering little t. So if little t is zero, so then I'm in the initial point. Yeah. So then my filtration is just the empty set and the full set. So everything is deterministic in little t. So I know everything. And the conditional expectation becomes an unconditional one. Yeah. So this means I get an unconditional expectation. And I know how to calculate unconditional expectation. So later I have a session on how to calculate conditional expectations in Monte Carlo. Yeah, that's a little bit more complicated, but here I need only an unconditional one. So I know how to calculate that. Generate samples of the random variable X and just take the average. Okay, so now we have our application, my model, my financial product, and in the end here, take the sum over the samples, and I would like to implement this. So let's have a small code session. So first part is implement this. So calculate the valuation of a European option under the Black-Scholes model using all the numerical methods, yeah, or some of the numerical methods we have developed so far. Yeah? So maybe I will not use Kahan summation. I will use that maybe a bit later. Yeah, so in my first try, but let's see. Let's create a small experiment here. So I create here a new class. So I call this now Monte Carlo Plaque-Scholes valuation experiment. I would like to have a main method, so where I can explore this a little bit. And before I start, yeah, I just define the model and product properties as constants here, or as fields to this class. So what do we have? I have an initial value. Let's say my stock is today at 100. Then I have the interest rate of my model. So this is the risk-free rate. Say the interest rate is at 5%. And then I have the volatility parameter of the stock, yeah, so the sigma. Say this is at 20%. Yeah? So this is the movement, the scaling factor in front of the Brownian motion. So these are actually the parameters. Initial value R sigma, describing the model. So next part is I have product parameters. So I'd like to value a financial product. So there is option maturity. So say I value the option, that is the capital T, in 1 year, and I have a certain strike. So assume the option strike is 105. So I get some payment if the stock is above 105 in 1 year, so in 1.0. So these are the product parameters. Then I like to do Monte Carlo. So I like to have a numerical methods. So for Monte Carlo, I need some parameters like the seed for the random number generator. So let's take some seed, 32, 16, something. And I need the number of sample passes. So number of sample passes, let's take 20 million, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Yeah, so that is 2 × 10⁷. Let's see. Okay, so now I would like to use these parameters in my little experiment. So now these parameters are the fields, that means they are not static. So if I like to access these parameters, I have to create an object out of this. So this here is now my experiment. And this experiment should have some methods calculating now the value. So the first method I like to implement is the analytic value, because I need to have some benchmark. So let's calculate the analytic value. So this is value analytic. So I ask now my experiment get analytic. Value and let's print that out. So that is now the analytic value. Okay, so now of course he's complaining, yeah, so that this method does not exist. So I like to create it. And here I calculate the analytic value. So for the analytic value, I have a formula. So there's a formula in this financial library that I provide together with this lecture. Yeah, so we can use FinMATLAB. So let's just use this analytic formula. So there is a class called analytic formulas in this library, and we have there a plaque Scholes option value. Yeah, so maybe you can use this. So this one uses initial stock value, risk-free rate, volatility option, maturity option, strike. So these are just the parameters which we have. So initial value, risk-free rate, volatility option, maturity option, strike. So that's right. Okay, and I can calculate now this value. So let's see what's the output if I now run this little test. Okay, so I get some output. Yeah, so the value is 8.0, so something like 8%. Yeah, my stock is initially at 100. This is the value of the option. So the next thing I would like to do is to calculate the value using a Monte Carlo method. And I would like just to use a plain Java loop. So get value using using loop, maybe I call it like this, that. Let's create this method. Okay, so, and I like to do a very traditional loop, yeah, to calculate the sum and hence the average of all the valuations. So for that, I need a random number generator that generates me the random number. So let's start with the random number generator. So I use Mersenne Twister. We saw that guy. So there's also a Mersenne Twister here in this library, and it takes as an argument the seed. Okay, and then I loop over all sample points. So now I have an integer running from 0 to my number of sample points. Okay, and inside this loop, I'm calculating the sum of all valuations. So I need to define this sum. And now I have to go through all the steps. So the first step is I have to generate the X on the slide. So the X on the slide was a normal distributed random variable with standard deviation 0. With mean 0 and standard deviation square root of t. So I know how to generate normal distributed random variables. I know the inversion of the distribution function applied to a uniform one. So my first number here is the uniform one. This is, I asked the random number generator for the next value. Then I generate the normal distributed one. So this is a standard normal using the inversion of the distribution function. We already had this. I can use here the normal distribution, the inverse of the cumulative distribution function of the uniform. So now I have a standard normal. This is on the slide, the Z. Okay, then I can generate. So maybe I make a comment here. So then I can generate the S. So S is now given as a function. So maybe you have a look. So my standard normal Z is now this guy. So I have to multiply that with square root of capital T, and then I have to multiply it with sigma, and then I have to add all this here and take the exponential and multiply the result with the initial value of the stock. So let's write this formula. So I have the initial value of the stock multiplied with the exponential of R times capital T. So this is the option maturity, minus 1/2 sigma squared. So that is from the move to the logarithm from Itô's lemma. So this is now volatility squared. Times option maturity times capital T plus sigma, so volatility times square root of capital T times the Z. So, and the Z was the normal distributed random variable. So that should be the S. So this is then the S of T. So this is, let's say, our model. So the next step is now the product. Yeah? So calculate the payoff V of T divided by N of T multiplied with N of little t. So that is now the discounted payoff. Or maybe I just calculate the payoff. So maybe I first calculate the payoff. The payoff is now the maximum of S of T, so maximum of the underlying, minus the option strike. Sorry, minus the option strike. And zero. So the payoff is maximum of S of T minus K and zero. Then I have the discount payoff. Okay, maybe I just add this directly to the sum. So the discounted payoff is the payoff multiplied with N of capital T divided by N of little t. So that is the exponential minus R, and now little t is zero, so minus R capital T. Okay, so that is the sum of all the values. So that's now this part here, the sum of all the values. So g of h of x, I have calculated now g of h of x for every omega. I've calculated the sum. So I just return the sum divided by the number of sample points. Okay, so let's keep fingers crossed. I believe that should be the Monte Carlo valuation of a Black-Scholes, of an European option under a Black-Scholes model. So let's print this out. So I'm using here a loop. Okay, so now it takes a few seconds. Okay, and whoops, I did not paste the right output. Okay, so let's try. Okay, so that looks quite nice. Yeah? So I have a small error. That should be the Monte Carlo error. Yeah? So you know my Monte Carlo error is of order square root of number of samples. So my number of samples is a 10 to the 6. So the Monte Carlo error should be a 10 to the minus 3, yeah, a little bit more, 3 to 4. Yeah, that's okay. Yeah, so that's here. A very good approximation. Okay, so I wrote here a that I calculate now this using a plain loop. And what you see from, say, a programming perspective, everything is really glued together. Yeah. So of course, I already tried to separate a little bit the mathematical concepts. This is the model. This is the product. This is the random number generation. Yeah, so I already have some separation here, but there is a big loop around this. It's the calculated path by path, and everything is a bit glued together. So if I like to exchange something, you would rather create everything again and then modify it. And then you have again and again the same code. A first step in a different direction is maybe seen if I use Java streams. We have seen a stream API, and I just like to do the same exercise again using now the stream API. So this is now the value Monte Carlo using streams. So I ask my experiment, get the value using streams. Okay, so let's have also a printout here, Monte Carlo value using streams. So, and of course he should print that one. He complains the method does not exist. Okay, let's create the method. So maybe you remember the stream API. I can generate a stream of random numbers. Yeah. And then I can transform the stream of random numbers by functions. And you see that on my slide here, I have already two transformations. There is the H, which is the transformation coming from the model, and there's the G, which is a transformation coming from the financial product. And my sequence of random numbers is generated here by the X. So maybe that is a nice exercise to use the Java streams API. So let's define the model as a function that transforms the X into the S. So that here is the model for S. So this is a function. So it's a double unary operator. And this operator transforms the X. Well, if you go back to the slide, I'm transforming here a standard normal Z into an S. So let's write this map. So this map transforms Z into, okay, initial value, S of 0, multiplied with the exponential of the risk-free rate, multiplied with the option maturity, RT, minus 1/2 sigma squared. So minus 1/2 volatility squared. Times T, so again, times option maturity. Plus sigma times square root of capital T times Z. So plus volatility times square root of option maturity times Z. So this is the formulation of the Black-Scholes model under the corresponding here equivalent martingale measure to the numerator e to the RT. Okay, so the next thing is the financial product. So the financial product is then a function that maps my S. So I have another unary operator that maps my S to the discounted payoff. So now I immediately use the discounted payoff. So that is the maximum of S minus K, so S minus option strike and zero. So that's the payment made by the product multiplied with the exponential minus RT, so multiplied with N of capital T, N of little t divided by N of capital T. So minus R times option maturity. So that is the discounted payoff function. So, and all I need now is a stream of normal distributed random numbers. So now this is the numerical method. Okay, so a stream of these numbers, I can use the Mersenne twister. So let's call this random number generator. So I use it with my seed. Then I can ask, okay, please generate a stream of uniform numbers. So this is now a double stream. Generated from this random number generator and limited to the number of samples. So this is my streams of uniforms. Now I transform this stream of uniforms to normals, standard normals. So this is, I use the stream of uniforms and I apply a function. Okay, and this function is now the normal distribution, which we used before, inverse cumulative distribution function. So inverse cumulative distribution function. So I apply now this function to these streams and it will create a new stream. Okay, there is a drop, something missing, okay. So now it works. Okay, and now I transform the stream of normals to the stream of underlying. So this is the map from Z to S. So this is normals. Apply the function that represents the model. Then the next stream is the payoffs. So discounted payoffs. So this is now take the underlying value and apply the financial product. Okay, and now I have the stream of all values V of capital T. Divided by n of capital T multiplied with n of little t. So of, out of this stream, I just need to calculate the sum. So I'm now done. So I just can calculate the value of the financial derivative is take the sum of this stream. And actually this function will automatically use the Kahan or summation, the error corrected summation, divided by the number of sample points. Okay, so you see this is very similar to what I did before, but actually I do not know the loop. Yeah, so the loop is actually hidden here in this generation of the random numbers. And below here, there has some abstraction taking place. I can actually apply this using any model and any financial product. So for any model and any financial product, I could use this here. So as long as it is a European option, yeah. So where I just have a model generating one stream and a product generating another stream, that could be a handy shortcut. So let's see if this gives a similar output. Yeah. So now I'm calling this value using streams and also I'm printing this value. Let's keep fingers crossed that this works. Yeah, so you see there's a small difference here, which is because this guy is using Kahan summation, yeah, or using an error corrected summation. This one is using another summation method. Okay, so now we have some description of the problem. And what I'd like to do next is discuss a little bit how we can structure this into interfaces and classes where different parts are performed by, say, different objects that we could reuse later. Okay, so let's start with this. It will be a longer journey because I also will discuss then how we implement an Euler scheme in the end. So in the end, I would like to implement an Euler scheme that could be used even for very complicated mathematical models, a very general version of it. So I will not finish this in this session, but maybe let's start discussing the first ideas. So going back to the slide, that was now my code session, the evaluation of a European option under the Black-Scholes model. So we were just walking through these steps here, generating random numbers, inversion of the distribution function, calculating the underlying using the model, calculating the payoff, calculating the expectation, and you can of course just look at this code in this Git repository. If you go back here to the slide, I already made the remark that all my arithmetic operations here are actually operations on random number on random variables. So if you have a plus here, it could be that I'm adding two random numbers. So this here is a constant, this is a constant. So these are floating point numbers, but this here is a random variable. So actually this plus here is an operation that adds a constant to a random variable, which gives me a new random variable. And then if you go back to the financial product, then you see this continues. So this minus here is a minus that subtracts k from a random variable, which gives me a new random variable, then that this random variable is multiplied with another random variable. Yeah. So it could be in more complicated models like the Library Market model, n will be stochastic. So it could be a product of random variables. So maybe a good object to design first is a random variable. Then another object is the Brownian motion, because I already mentioned that here in this equation, this guy here is the guy that is introducing the randomness to the whole model. So this guy contains two important parts. The first step is, how do I generate the uniform distributed random numbers? And the second step is, how do I generate the normal distributed random numbers from the uniforms? So if you do Monte Carlo, if I have a Monte Carlo random variable, the random number generation stuff is inside this guy. So maybe this guy is another thing that I should consider to belong to a separate class, being abstracted from all the other guys by an interface. So an interface describing a Brownian motion. Okay, so random variables and Brownian motions. So let's shortly review what is the mathematical thing here. So for a random variable, many arithmetic operations which we define are pathwise operators. So what does this mean? So I have a pathwise operator. That means I define an operator, say here this little circle, by just lifting it from the image space of the random variable. So assume all the random variables are real valued. So the image space is the real numbers. So if I have an operator defined on the real numbers, I define the operator on the random variables by defining it path by path. Yeah. So like on a vector space, element by element, an element wise operation, this is now a pathwise operation. So I can define a plus, a minus, a multiplication of two random variables as just a pathwise operator. And this will shorten my code if I have an object that is a random variable and if I can calculate plus, minus, exponential, logarithm of these random variables. There are a few operators that are non-pathwise. So operators which combine different omegas. Yeah. Examples are the expectation and the conditional expectation. For example, expectation is just taking the sum over all omegas and dividing by the number of samples if I have a finite dimensional random variable. And then I can interpret the result of this non-pathwise operator again as a random variable. The expectation, unconditional expectation, is a random variable which is constant. Yeah, for every omega, it is just the expectation. Yeah, it's just a constant. So it's also an operator mapping a random variable to another random variable, yeah, like a unary operator, like squared. Yeah. X squared is also mapping a single random variable to a new random variable. It's a unary operator, but it's a special one. It's combining different omegas, and for the expectation, the result is a deterministic one. For the Brownian motion, we had the definition already a while ago on the slides. So the Brownian motion is characterized by these four properties. And actually, property number four tells us almost everything. So the increments, so the difference wt minus ws for two times, t larger or equal than s, is normally distributed with mean zero and variance proportional to the time step size. Okay, so all the increments are independent, so we have independent increments. So this means that on a time discretization, this tells us how to construct the Brownian motion at discrete times. So it tells me how do I construct W of Ti? Well, W of Ti is just the telescope sum, J from 0 to I minus 1, of the increments W delta WTJ, where delta WTJ is an xj, or to be in the notation, yeah, to be in the notation with this little example from the Plek-Scholz model, the xj, the driver, the xj, and that xj is a normal distributed random variable with mu equals zero and sigma equals square root of delta tj. So the time step size. Okay, so I just can generate this guy by generating a vector of normal distributed random variables where the elements of the vector are mutually independent. Okay, so this means I need to generate random numbers, normal distributed random numbers in higher dimension. So if this here Tn is a Tk, so because on the slide it's also Tk, then I have k steps, yeah, from 0 to 1, 1 to 2, k minus 1 to k. So this means I have a k-dimensional random vector. So vector of random variables. Okay, so now I have two mathematical concepts, random variables and the Brownian motion. That was a picture here from the script which we had earlier, you know, the intuition for the Brownian motion. So you have the independent increments. And now I can define interfaces that describe what can be done with a random variable, so arithmetic operations, and what is provided by a Brownian motion. So the interface is on the abstract level describing the mathematical object, but it's not describing how it is implemented. The implementation is then a separate part. So I will introduce now three different interfaces, three different abstractions. The first one is the random variable, an object where I can perform arithmetic operations plus, minus, yeah, I can scale it, multiply with a scalar, I can translate it, add a scalar. Then I have a next object, the time discretization. So the time discretization which appeared in the Brownian motion. And then I have the Brownian motion. A time discretized Brownian motion. So a time discretization plugged in into the Brownian motion constructor together with a specification of how random numbers are then generated. So the Brownian motion provides these Brownian increments. These are just the interfaces. The interfaces described how it is, what can be done with this object, but not how it is done. The implementation says then how it is done, but the implementation can vary. For example, I can have different implementations for random variables using floating point numbers with single precision or double precision. So for a random variable, I could use here different implementations which provide different accuracies, but also if I store the random variable in memory, have different requirements with respect to the memory. For the Brownian motions, I could have many different implementations related to how random numbers are generated. Yeah, pseudo random number generation, quasi random number generation, and so on. Different means of generating the normal distributed increments. When you have different implementations for these interfaces, but you use only the interface in your calculation, then you are able to exchange the implementation at a later point in time. And this is sometimes called dependency injection. Okay, so now I have these interfaces defined. So we should walk through these interfaces. And I have several different implementations for the interfaces. So here I have two different examples for a random variable and also two different examples for Brownian motions. Since time's up, we should review this in the next session. So maybe in the next session, I will repeat again this little section here on random variables and Brownian motions. And then I like to implement this little example here again with the calculation of the normal value of a European option, then using my classes that implement these interfaces. And then we will see that later we can reuse a lot of this code, and we do not need to write stuff again and again. Yeah? For example, the point in motion will occur again and again. And once we have written it once, we can reuse it in many different places. So time is up, and that was it for today. Yeah, thank you.